Hello. We have this extreme privilege and honor to have a conversation with Professor Abu Nimer, who's an expert on conflict resolution and dialogue for peace. And he has over 20 years of teaching experience. And he is currently a full-time professor at American University School of International Service in Washington, D.C. Thank you so much, sir, for giving your time to us and agreeing to have this conversation with us. My name is Sagar, and I work with Seeds of Peace, and this is my colleague.
Hi, I'm Prerna. So I also went to school at American University, and thankfully he was my professor. And now we are actually a part of Towards an Inclusive Peace. And we want to ask you, how has been your experience so far being a part of Towards an Inclusive Peace and here at Caux?
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you for taking the time to talk. I'm also senior advisor at KAICIID, the International Center for Intercultural and Interreligious Dialogue in Vienna. And we have a team who has worked here as well.
Yes.
My experience has been marvelous, excellent, energizing, and all the good things. I've been coming to Caux since 1992 from the first Caux Scholar program, and coming back here every other year. And as I said in the talk, I come here for many reasons. One of them is that, of course, the inspiring stories that you hear from so many different people around the world, but also to be recharged from the calmness and the kindness and the stillness of the place. And it's really wonderful to have such a privilege for at least a week during the year. And I always recommend the place for my colleague and the friends as well. Also the theme of inclusive peace is very much timely, and dealing with it, with violent extremism through that is I think a very good step that the program can help peace practitioner reframe the approach to counter violent extremism.
Absolutely. And also, you've done so much research and written more than, I guess, 13 books on conflict transformation, faith-based peace building, and numerous articles. So can you please tell us about certain practical challenges as well as approaches of practice in this field?
In what area? Like
in peace building.
In peace building.
Yes.
Your work in mediation, and your also work in Israel, Palestine.
Yeah, I mean, geographically, I've worked in the Middle East. I've worked in South Asia, in Sri Lanka and Philippines. I've worked in Chad, Niger, Burkina Faso, in many parts of the world. Basically, where there is a conflict, where identity-based conflict, what we call them, and where religion is manipulated by politicians as well as by religious leaders. I mean, there's a couple of challenges. That come to my mind in working in these areas, particularly during those 10 or 15 years of dealing with religion. Really the challenge of having the religious institutes as agency making a genuine, serious commitment to work on social justice, on peace building. So the clergy and as well the people who are working in this agency are more genuinely committed as opposed to lip service, particularly among the dominant majorities in those countries. And it's the same exact challenge we face with the policymakers in any conflict area, is to go beyond the lip service statements and declaration, and to be genuine in engaging with religious leaders. A second challenge that we usually face is really with the religious institutions and agencies who work on faith-based peace building. It's really the lack of capacity or weak capacity. So, and that's why I usually say, you know, faith is not. Faith alone is not enough to do genuine peace building. It's good, it's necessary, but it's not enough. You have to have the programming, you have to have the capacity to plan, to evaluate, to monitor, and to be systematic in your approach. But unfortunately, many of the religious agency in conflict area, this is not necessarily their priority. Understandably, their priority usually is the survival, catering for refugees, for IDPs, for for people who have also other basic needs. Maybe a third challenge during these days is for the field of interreligious peacebuilding, mm-hmm. and peacebuilding in general, mm-hmm. is how to survive financially and methodologically without being sucked into the counter-violence, extremism, methodologies and the framing that mm-hmm. comes from the security, or as I said, misframing it by focusing only on one religion, Islam, mm. and committing the mistake, I think is a real, real challenge. The mistake of doing peace building, but from a security perspective, mm. from intelligence perspective, rather than from social justice perspective. Those are the three things that currently I'm dealing with.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
And I think you have also started the Salam Institutes for Peace and Justice. Of course, you have been working for so long in this this sector. So I was just wondering that what inspired you to start this institute, and what is the impact that you have had so far? We would be really curious to know about that.
Yeah, it's an interesting. I started this with a couple of colleagues in, after 9/11 mm-hmm. in 2002, 2003. Okay. Really to respond to the notion that in order to work on with the Muslim community in different parts of the world, one need to have an insider perspective mm-hmm. rather than an outsider coming to impose an agenda. And that has been the main motivator, mm-hmm. because I have seen many people come to different parts of the community mm-hmm. without necessarily understanding the complexity and the nuances of that local community. Mm. So we argued that for you to be effective on the ground, you need to know the discourse, the narrative, you need to work from the inside out, from bottom up, and also middle out. All of these terminology from peace building mean that you don't rely on outsider to dictate the agenda. Second thing is really for more of focus on unique topics and issues. For example, in the last 6 years, Salam been working on forgiveness and reconciliation mm-hmm. with the assumption that you cannot work in the Arab region mm-hmm. With the Arab Spring and all the chaos that mm-hmm. have taken in that region mm-hmm. without addressing forgiveness and reconciliation. Mm-hmm. I think that's one of the things. Another unique project we did was on training of madrasa schools. Right. Teachers in Chad, Niger, Burkina Faso, and other areas, where we created manuals for teachers in how to teach pluralism, diversity, non-violence, and peace building inside the Quranic schools. And it was good success. Mm-hmm. We've had number of evaluations in this area where teachers managed to integrate some of these concepts and values in a more more integrative way.
I was also kind of stunned when you shared your perspective today on violent extremism. We have been discussing it for the last 4 days, and you shared that how fear is being used as a strategy. And the next question that comes to my mind is then, how do we change this framework of fear? And at a very basic level, you know, like what the youth can do about it, what the young peace activists or young peace builders can do about it.
The concept of fear, as I said, the issue with it, it reduces the learning, because mm-hmm. people under fear cannot learn. They want to defend themselves, protect themselves. So the best cure for it is really to not operate out of fear, but to operate in the peace building framework mm-hmm. out of compassion, out of caring, out of love for other people. And this human connection should be the base, and establishing ongoing relationship mm-hmm. is, I think, the starting point. I'm not the mechanical one. I'm coming to help you protect yourself from this monster that's called terrorism. Right. It is a monster, but it's not really the most helpful and productive way. It's effective maybe for a short term, but for long term, it doesn't build a relationship between European, American, and the Middle East, Muslim world, or South Asia, or Africa. it's in my view, it's even counterproductive because it doesn't have the trust of the community. So one thing we've been arguing to, in a way to say, if you can afford not to work with CVE, then reject it as a peace builder. Mm-hmm. But if you cannot afford because of the donors and the funder, then at least make sure that in the core values that you work with under CVE, it's not fear, but it's trust. It's not fear, but it's contact and encounter and meeting the other based on social justice, based on human rights values, as opposed based on how can I be less fearful of the other.
Wonderful. Thank you so
Thank you so much for
us this different frame of reference to kind of tackle violent extremism through building trust, human connection, and not just using fear
or security lens.
And security lens.
I think one thing you ask about the youth, I think one thing I always admire working with youth groups and stakeholders is that youth can break those barriers of fear easier, more creatively, and can take that step forward toward the other more than older people like myself and others. So that's what the youth can do. They can show us that meeting the other is not so risky.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.